my concerns and worries about the world around us have changed.
I'm more focused on seeing things through.
There's no cage that we're in, there's no musical box. It's any idea, any germ. We have no idea what kind of tree it will flower into. Wrote and recorded the first Audioslave record, we had never played a single live show as a band. We jumped straight into the deep end with the first record and began to learn how to play together, how to gel together as a live band over that first tour.
A lot of times you'll tour and then you'll take a lot of time off and chops will kind of fade away and you'll have to kind of work back up to it, so.
We kind of wanted to break that cycle up and be more of a rock band like rock bands used to be, where you spend a lot of time writing songs, recording songs, making records a lot, and also always performing.
The bands that we grew up and were influenced by, you know, made records about every year.
Led Zeppelin and bands like that, they would tour and they would feel that it was hot on the road, and they'd take that straight into the studio.
We came off tour, we rehearsed, we went in the studio, we went on tour, we went back in the studio, we hammered it and we did it, and it's paid off. I think some of the songs, because we didn't pay too much attention to them, they didn't suffer, you know, and they're preserved.
Every song we write really is in a room with all four of us together. Somebody starts playing a part or someone has an idea that day, and we don't leave until that, whatever that idea is, becomes what we feel is pretty close to a finished song.
It doesn't matter whether it's a drum beat or a bass line or guitar part or vocal melody or whatever it may be. It could be just a sound.
You know, I'll wake up in the morning and I'll hear some truck that, you know, is going down the street that's, you know, mixing with, you know, some construction work or whatever, and I'll hear these crazy rhythms, and that kind of stuff really does inspire me, and they stick in my head throughout the day, and then I'll get on the kit, and I'll try and emulate what I heard, and, you know, it's from that to even, you know, birds and all kinds of shit. You just open up your ears, and there's so many rhythms going on continually throughout a day.
Whatever inspires you, and if it sounds good, then it's good.
We worked with Brendan O'Brien on this record. Brendan has produced some of our best records in the past. Brendan produced Evil Empire and Battle of Los Angeles from Rage Against the Machine. He also mixed Soundgarden's Super Unknown. He works fast and furious and gets the best out of the immediacy of a take.
Brendan is an amazing musician as well. So it really was five cooks in the kitchen.
For the first time, I think, in many, many years, I actually recorded standing out in a room and singing while an engineer recorded me, and a producer just asked questions and asked me to do different things and then said, "You're done, go home." The way I've been doing it for years is I do it myself inside a studio, no one else is there. I engineer, record all my own vocals, make my own decisions. That was very different. Brendan's decisiveness and his ear as a musician I totally trust, which is rare.
I think this record is definitely the funkiest Audioslave record. It wasn't something that was even thought about or done on purpose. Once we just started getting into a room, just kind of started happening. You know, I've always been influenced by Funk, George Clinton, P-Funk, James Brown.
You know, my favorite bands are all rock bands. You know, I love Free and the Beatles and Led Zeppelin, but my favorite singers are not in rock bands. All my favorite singers my whole life tended to be R&B or soul singers like Stevie Wonder and Otis Redding.
From my own perspective, from a bass perspective, I felt that maybe there could be more funkiness infused in Audioslave, you know, and this record has got a lot of that. There's some songs that are just flat out funk, you know, and it feels good. It feels good to kind of get back to that.
Timmy and Brad are really like nail an almost Motown beat sometimes, and sometimes it's a ridiculously dirty Parliament kind of funk to it. But at the same time, you know, it's electric guitars blazing too.
I listened to everything from John Coltrane, you know, Elvin Jones, to John Bonham, to Dave Garibaldi, who was a teacher of mine who used to play in Tower of Power. The more you pick from the different barrels, the better chance you have of sort of creating something that is unique.
My biggest inspirations were Sid Vicious and Geddy Lee. I learned how to play like every Sex Pistols song, and then somewhere along the line, I just like veered off that path and just went, I like prog rock. And so like, I just became obsessed like in high school with Geddy Lee, this, you know, the bass player Rush, and Rush was like my band that I loved to go see. And that was what inspired me to become a musician. That maybe when I was with Rage and I was kind of embarrassed, people go, what were your influences? You know, when like right when Rage started, and I'd be like, well, I like the Sex Pistols. And I wouldn't bring up Rush. I wouldn't bring it up because I was kind of slightly embarrassed of all that time that I spent with Rush. But now it's like here I am in a band that is heavily influenced by that kind of music. And Chris and Brad, who both love Rush. Tom's not a big Rush fan, but Chris and Brad love Rush. And, you know, so 3 out of 4 is not bad.
I think living in L.A. is interesting because there's parts of L.A. that are very isolated and you can sort of be away from people, and there's also parts of LA where people just kind of walk around isolated and with blinders. It's weird, there's not really a center in Los Angeles either. You know, most cities, they have centers, and Los Angeles sort of is a city without a center.
Mouth of a city swallowed up the town. Well, that same old concrete that I still walk down, and it seemed they put a shine on this place when I was young. Well, maybe I just don't see it now.
The song Out of Exile from our last record was really about my wife being pregnant with a child, and at a time when that I really needed something in my life to believe in and to focus on that was positive, and how that really pulled me out of a bad period in my life. When I was writing lyrics for this record, I had two new children. And I notice now more that my family shows up in lines of a song, where the song isn't necessarily about my family, but rather than writing from the perspective of I am me, one person, and I'm writing from this perspective, I'm more writing from the perspective of me and my family here, and this is what I'm thinking about.
I'm more focused on seeing things through, you know, like whether it's a tattoo or a song or cleaning up the house or whatever it may be. It's like, I don't like to go half and half step and not see it through.
I think one of the aspects that is probably the struggle in the life of any type of an artist is that you don't really want to grow up. And in fact, if you can make a living being a rock singer or a songwriter, you're sort of allowed to live your life as a child. But to me, artistically, and just in terms of every possible human emotion and experience, having children the only thing that compares to it, I suppose, is your own birth and death. I mean, other than that, nothing is more dramatic or life-changing. And something that dramatic and all-encompassing in your life is an incredible inspiration for any kind of art. I don't care if I never hear a person write another song about a stripper or a motorcycle again. I don't care. But, you know, it's not exciting to me.
Events have definitely shaped who we are as people, and that definitely filters into the music. You know, in these very troubled times where it is a world at risk, and predominantly put at risk by the policies of our own country, is something that, you know, I'm very, very much aware of. Chris is the sole lyricist of the band, and I think his lyrics are often open to various interpretations. There are definitely some songs on this record that are leaning in a more, finger-pointing direction. Which I think is healthy in these times.
As far as writing topical songs or songs with any type of a political opinion, I've never done that unless it really happens organically in that way, like it just pops into my head. And if it comes into my head organically, then I tend to suddenly get motivated about expressing my feelings about it.
We have a song about President Bush and what an ass he is. You know, it's pretty cool.
It's encouraging that there's a that there's an edge to the lyrics in Audioslave that, you know, resonates with my political leanings. And I think this, you know, it's in times like these, you know, you're either a part of the solution or you're a part of the problem. And in our way, we're doing our best to be a part of the solution.
I hope that our vision and the vision of the masses coincide. It's not an easy thing to pull off, but hopefully it'll work out. It's true.